thank Claire. She reached out to me when the book first came out, and thank Anne, and thank everyone at Mothers at Home Matter, and thank all of you for coming to hear me today. I think the work that Mothers at Home Matter is so critical, and I think even the name of the organization suggests how critical the work is, that we need an organization called Mothers at Home Matter. Okay. Isn't it obvious that mothers at home matter, and why shouldn't it be obvious? But I'm going to start today, before I start, by reading a Maya Angelou poem. It is true, I was created in you. It is also true that you were created for me. I owned your voice. It was shaped and tuned to soothe me. Your arms were molded into a cradle to hold me, to rock me. The scent of your body was the air, perfumed for me to breathe. It's a beautiful poem, and there's a lot of other beautiful poems that she's written about motherhood, but the reason I like that poem is because essentially it talks about what is so critical about mothers. It talks about the emotional regulation that mothers do for children and the cues to that emotional regulation. So I will get more into that, but that poem says it all. I'm going to do a little reading for the book quickly to give you a sense of why my book is about the joy of mothering, not the burden of mothering. Yes, I agree with Claire. Too much is made of the burden, and all jobs, whether they're paid or non-paid, have boring moments and burdensome moments. I mean, tell me one job that you can do that doesn't have a boring moment or a burdensome moment. But the overall and pervasive feeling of mothering has lost its joy, the joyfulness of nurturing. And that's part of the problem. So I'm going to read you a little bit about joy and mothering. You are sitting on the floor with your one-year-old, close to him but giving him room to play. You make eye contact frequently and lovingly touch him often. You watch him play, cooing and observing and describing his emotions and actions to him. You smile when he smiles at you and wait patiently when he needs to look away or at an object, ready to re-engage when he gives you the cues he is ready. When he is frustrated or angry, you mirror his feelings, using your voice and facial expressions. It is helpful to try to imagine your own experience of discovery and wonder as a baby looking at and touching an object for the first time, experiencing it with your own mother. You are enjoying sitting on the floor, playing with your baby, and being engaged in the experience, not thinking about the dishes in the sink or your emails that are waiting. You and your baby are involved in a dance of connection and space, attachment and separation, engagement and disengagement, rupture and repair. Sometimes your baby leads and you follow, and sometimes you lead and your baby follows. This playfulness and intimacy help shape your baby's developing brain and personality. To do this, you must be in the moment, let go of all the adult means of distraction and stimulation. Focusing on eye contact, touch, and your tone of voice, facial expression, body language, and awareness of your own mood and emotions. Sometimes you get bored or sleepy when playing with your baby, feeling understimulated yourself. This is as natural as when your baby looks away for a moment to collect himself and take a break from you. If you wait, then the moment passes and you re-engage with your baby. The Oxford Dictionary defines presence as the state or fact of existing, occurring, or being present. Physical presence being the most obvious form of being there. Certainly without a mother's physical presence, there is no emotional presence for a child. However, it is important that a mother can be with her child physically, but still be emotionally checked out. For a mother to be present, she must first be self-aware of and accept her own sometimes conflicted feelings about motherhood. In addition, she must be willing to make her child a priority in the time she spends with her. This means not only spending as much time as possible with a child during their first 3 years of life, but also focusing on how that time is spent. We're addicted to multitasking, reading our emails while watching TV, sneaking a peek at our text messages at the dinner table, Yet researchers like Earl Miller have shown that, in fact, that kind of divided attention is both destructive to relationships and stressful to individuals. So I wrote this book because I've been a parent guidance expert and psychoanalyst, dealing specifically with families who come to me for help when their children are starting to show signs of distress or difficulty. And for the past almost 30 years, I saw a trend in my practice, a worsening trend, of mental disorders at an earlier and earlier age in younger and younger children being diagnosed and then medicated as early as 2 years old. Suicidal ideation in children as young as 4 and 5 years old. Distractibility, ADHD, early signs of aggression, and social disorders mimicking autism. And it disturbed me. And in my practice, I was seeing a connection between the absence of mothers on a daily basis in children's lives and those mental disorders. And so I went about treating mothers using my background by helping those mothers, whether they were working or non-working, to be as present as possible for those children, both physically and emotionally. And it worked. Over 30 years, it reduced the symptomology of the children, sometimes actually eliminated it. And so, right, about 12 years ago, I said, I'm going to write a book. And you'd say I was quite an annoyance to my husband and everyone around me because it's all I talked about. I'm thinking the only reason you write a book, you don't make any money, there's no money, and then you write a book because you have something to say and you can't shut up about it. So I couldn't shut up about it because it was so disturbing to me and I was so passionate about getting the message out. And so 12 years ago I said, right, I'm going to write a book about this. And then my children were very young. I have an 18-year-old, a 16-year-old, and a 13-year-old. And if I'd written the book then, it would have defied the principle of my book, which is you can do everything in life, you just can't do it all at the same time. I'm actually a living example of what I say in the book. Mm-hmm. I lived a very quiet life until just the last couple of years in this book. I was a very small-time psychoanalyst with a small practice. I didn't go to conferences. I wasn't fancy. I didn't participate in any of my institutes or I took care of my children and I had a small practice because I knew that the time would come when I would be freed up more to do what I needed to do in life. So we can do everything in life. And the women that I interviewed for the book, across the board, many of them were women who are incredibly successful but didn't have to do it when they were raising small children. They weren't CEOs and congresswomen, which is the equivalent of your MPs, or while they were raising small children, and yet they could be very successful later in life when they were freed up from having such dependent children. And so I truly believe that women can do everything in life, just not all at the same time. But I also believe that more is more, that the more emotionally and physically present we are for our children in the first 3 years, which is what researchers call the critical period of brain development, the first 1,000 days, by the end of the third year, 85% of your child's social emotional brain, their prefrontal cortex, which is the social emotional part, and the limbic system, which is the alarm part of the brain that alarms us to stress and helps us to motivate to deal with stress, is really developed. And so it is a critical window of development. Once it's gone, we don't get it back. Yes, the brain is plastic and we can repair a great deal, but the truth is that it is a critical period of development. There is an increasing devaluing of mothering in the world. It's not just in America, it's everywhere. I mean, I am here and I'm talking to people here, it's the same here. I'm talking to people from Sweden, it's the same in Sweden. I'm talking to people in Australia, it's the same in Australia. It's the same everywhere, which is that mothering is now seen as not valuable work. And yet it's the most valuable work. What could possibly be more valuable than raising emotionally healthy children that you're sending out into the world who will be emotionally healthy adults? Can you think of anything more valuable than that? And yet because we're not paid, because there's no status to it, it's devalued, right? Now, does it counter the feminist movement? I mean, feminists came out and did a great service to all of us. Why? Because they gave us choices. They gave us the choice to have children or not to have children. and still be valuable in society if you don't have children. We have the choice to have very linear careers, and we also have the choice to have children and take some time off and get out of the linear career paths we're on, and raise our children and go back. So it gave us choices. And I think what's happened is the pendulum has swung too far, right? Where now, you know, we say in the 60s and 70s, Gloria Steinem said to women in America, if you don't go to work, you're a traitor to feminism. And that has stood today as the mantra to feminism. And so there's a war, really, in America, and probably here too, between the mothers who choose to stay home or can stay home and have to sacrifice a lot, most of them, to do so, and the mothers who go to work. And I don't like that war. I don't want that war. All women should support each other. We have each other to support. And yet, the people we should be supporting the most are the children. So what I call for in the book, using every bit of research that I could gather from the last 75 years, including the most recent research, because I met the head of the National Institute of Mental Health when I was at a conference a few years ago, and he put me in touch with all of the most current neuroscience epigenetics researchers that I then interviewed for my book and put as much research into this book, including attachment research and neuroscience and epigenetics and psychoanalytic literature. So it's filled with research. Because why? Because we need research to understand that mothers are valuable. And that's fine, because there is a lot of research. There's an entire body of research to say that mothers are not just emotionally necessary to children, but in fact are biologically necessary. What does that mean, that they're biologically necessary to grow the right brain of a baby? So they do a couple of really critical things. One is they regulate a baby's emotions from moment to moment. Every time a mother soothes a baby in distress, she's actually helping that baby to not go too high or too low with their emotions. She's bringing the baby back to what we call homeostasis. And after 3 years of doing that for the baby from the outside, the baby is then able to internalize self-regulation, or the ability to regulate their own emotions. So what we're seeing in society now, in very young children, and older children, and adolescents, and adults, are disorders of emotional regulation. Depression and anxiety are disorders of emotional regulation, when people cannot regulate the highs and lows in their emotions. And so that's one critical thing, because after that 3-year period, that's when the baby can internalize it. Second really critical thing that mothers do is they buffer children from stress from moment to moment. Every time a mother comforts a baby, touches a baby, she's actually protecting the baby from stress. So what we understand now is that babies are born much more neurologically fragile than we've ever understood before. Some theories say that mothers are the central nervous system to babies in the first 9 months, and other theories say babies are born 18 months too early, and the only reason they're born is not because of the size of their head, which is what we previously thought, but because mothers energetically could never carry a baby physically for another 18 months. And yet, from a neurological perspective, they probably should not be out in the world. And, you know, the reality is it's more like marsupial caring. You know, mothers in other parts of the world, because I interviewed researchers that do research on mothering. There's one lady in Holland who's wonderful, has done a lot of research on whether mothering is culturally relative, universal or culturally relative. And what she found is, oh no, it's universal. And what do mothers do for babies in other parts of the world? They carry them like marsupials on their body. Jane Goodall also just has a wonderful film that just came out, and she was interviewed about it. And she said, even in observing chimps, she said that, you know, babies that cling to their mothers and live on their mother's bodies, when they're in distress, they need only to pull on the mother's hair or make a small sound, and the mother's skin-to-skin contact and voice and eye contact immediately soothes the baby. So what this researcher found is that babies in other parts of the world, not Western parts, cry less. They actually are under less stress and in less distress. than in the Western world, where we demand that our babies are separate from our bodies, separate from us. We demand self-sufficiency at a very young age, when in fact, neurologically, we know that cortisol or stress hormones in the brain do no good for babies, or for grown-ups, by the way. And what we understand is that mothers produce something called oxytocin, which is a neuropeptide in the brain. They produce it when they nurture, they produce it when they give birth, they produce it when they breastfeed, and they produce it when they nurture a baby. Every time you have skin-to-skin contact with a baby, or you make eye contact with your baby, you're actually producing oxytocin in your brain, but guess what? You're also producing it in the baby's brain. And think of it like baseball. I guess I could say think of it like cricket. I'm not sure it's an analogy for cricket. You'll have to tell me. But you need a pitcher and a catcher. I guess it's different. But if the mother is the pitcher of oxytocin, the baby is the catcher. But the baby can only catch oxytocin if the baby has enough oxytocin receptors. The more you nurture, the more it lightens the it creates more oxytocin receptors. And what we know of the research, there's so much research, I couldn't even come close to talking about all the research, so read the book because there's so much research, but there's a very famous researcher named Michael Meany who did research to show that when mother rats licked and groomed their young were much more resilient to stress in life than the babies who were not licked and groomed and touched and nurtured. And what he discovered is that nurturing is passed down generationally, meaning if a mother doesn't nurture her baby, her daughter then does not know how and cannot nurture her young. So, you know, we've learned a lot from the research to understand that, you know, there is a critical relationship between a mother and a baby in terms of the inverse relationship between oxytocin and stress. So we know that oxytocin production is inversely related to stress hormones, meaning if we're stressed, oxytocin goes down, but oxytocin is a defender, a protector, a buffer against cortisol and stress hormones. The more the mother is there in the first 3 years to protect the baby from stress, the less stressed that baby is. Right? And we know what stress does. So stress is like, there's a little part of the brain called the amygdala, little almond-shaped, very old part of the brain, which comes from our evolutionary predatorial days when we were running, fight or flight, remember, running from predators. What do we do when we're faced with a predator? We either run or we fight. So what we're seeing in very young children is a fight or flight response. But think of it like the amygdala as like a light switch that goes on when we're under stress, and it actually motivates our body to get ready to deal with the stress. Think of it today like a light switch that gets stuck. Everybody's had a light switch in their house that gets stuck in the on position and then you can't get it like unstuck and you gotta call the electrician. Well, think of it like that. The stress hormones get going, but then you can't get them ungoing. There's no off button. And if there's no off button, then what happens is the baby goes into what we call a hypervigilant state, either hyper or hypo. First, hyper. Hyper is running from the predator, right? We go into a state of distractibility, hyperactivity, extreme movement, and anxiety. Mm-hmm. If that light switch stays on long enough, guess what happens? It burns out. The amygdala shrinks, shrivels up, and we go into a hypo state. So what would be the opposite? When we get depressed, when we maybe don't react to risky situations that we should react to. And so, yeah, we say in America, Houston, we have a problem. Right, so the book is essentially not a book for working mothers or stay-at-home mothers. Obviously, it's a book that I wrote to advocate, to educate. Mm. To create a child-centric society. But in America, we have an issue of absolutely no paid maternity leave. Women go back, 27% of women in America go back to work after 2 weeks. So before their bodies are healed and before. So we make a distinction, at least I do, between bonding and attachment. Bonding can happen right away and sometimes not. If you didn't have that relationship with your own mother, because what happens when you give birth is we say it either opens up the glorious, joyful mother door, or it opens up the depressed, neglected mother door. And you don't know if you don't have memories of your mother, meaning if you defensively idealized her or didn't remember what it was like to be a tiny baby. When you have a baby, it's almost like a psychotic experience because it opens up experiences that you never may have remembered. Mm-hmm. Some of them happy, some of them not so happy. And the problem is, again, in America, we also have at least 1 in 5, I think it's more like 2 in 5 women with postpartum depression. And when I say 2 in 5, it's because 1 in 5 women are diagnosed with postpartum depression because they're vegetatively depressed, meaning they can't get out of bed, or they're crying all the time, or they start to have fantasies about hurting themselves or hurting their babies. That's what's being diagnosed as postpartum depression. But really, as a psychoanalyst who does this all the time, what I see as not being diagnosed are the women who say, I can't bear to be with my baby. It's boring. I don't like it. I don't like being around babies. I'll wait till they get older to be around them. That is postpartum depression. It is actually natural to be bored with somebody else's baby. Because nature makes it that unless the investment is true, that maybe you can be bored with someone else's baby. But to be bored with your own baby, whether it's by nature or an adoptive baby that has been handed to you that is now your baby, which the investment biologically is shown to be the same. Mothers who adopt babies produce oxytocin. Do they can even produce milk? But the idea is that if you are bored with your baby and being with your baby, that is a sign of postpartum. We're not helping those mothers, and we're not helping those babies by, as society, saying, fine, you don't have to stay home with your baby, they'll be fine, you go to work, or you leave your baby, it's fine. We're not helping those mothers, we're not helping them to resolve conflicts they have, we're not helping them to resolve their own depressed feelings. Right, so we have an issue, and I'm sure you have the issue here too, of women feeling very conflicted. Now the other thing that's happening is that women are feeling conflicted, which is a good thing, because the conflicted women who may feel guilty, for me, guilt means that your conscience is working, that your ego is functioning, mm-hmm. that you actually feel empathy for your baby's pain, which is a good thing. It's not a bad thing. It means you actually are feeling for your baby, because the other thing that I didn't mention is what happens in the first 3 years is you're developing the empathy in your baby's brain. So a lot of these mothers who cannot be empathic for their babies never had mothers who were empathic towards them, right? Either had attachment disorders of their own, you know, had a kind of dissociation. We're big on dissociation too in society, right? We zone out watching TV or eating or drinking or doing drugs or looking at our phones. Looking at our phones is a type of dissociation. And everybody does it. Babies do it too. They do temporarily. They use their defenses. They're overstimulated or they're overtired or their mother hasn't looked at them for a few minutes. They'll look away, right? Sometimes they'll go to sleep. So that's a kind of disconnection and dissociation, but it's a temporary defense, and then the baby looks back at the mother. Problem is that we as a society and mothers in general are using it more frequently, more chronically. So I'm sure everyone in this room understands what attachment disorders are, but what we're seeing is basically how attachment disorders in early childhood, because that's basically what we're talking about here, how attachment disorders are impacting mental health in children later on, right? And so in the book, there's almost an entire chapter on how to spot attachment disorders. So, you know, what we understand is some babies temperamentally, and genetically, now we understand because we know the science of epigenetics, which is the science of understanding that we're born with a set of genes that may mean that we're more predetermined to develop certain diseases. Or in the case of the research around this topic, researchers have found that many more babies than we understood in the past are born with what we call sensitivity, are sensitive babies. They're born with what we understand to be a short allele on the serotonin receptor. Serotonin is necessary to feel joy, to regulate joy. We know that many babies are born at a disadvantage genetically, meaning they're more prone to depression and anxiety in the long run. The research shows that those babies when they receive sensitive empathic maternal nurturing in the first 3 years, that nurturing neutralizes the expression of that gene. So those children have as great a chance of being emotionally healthy as a child who doesn't have that sensitivity. Now, what does a sensitive baby look like? They are less easy to soothe when they're in distress. Some people call them colicky. They might have eczema on their skin when they're born, or a little bit of eczema. They're babies that seem under stress and in distress from sounds and light and even touch. And I mean, I could ask you, but I don't need to. Everybody, I mean, I had a sensitive baby. I have three children, and one of my three children, I'm sure, was born with that determination. And had I not been there, he probably would have been maybe on medication someday, or might have suffered from a mental disorder. And he's fine, but he wouldn't have been. So a big part of the book is really looking, knowing what to look for, right? If you have to work, mothers have to work today, some of them, for financial reasons, because we basically made it impossible in every country for mothers to do this critical work of being with their children. And when mothers have to work, or when they enjoy working a little bit, it gives them pleasure to work. We can't take work away from women, but what we do need to do is, in spite of that, have ways to be as present for our children, to repair when we're not there, to know what to look for when our children are not doing well in the face of our absence, because it's only when we can look at our children's pain that we can help them. If we turn away from the pain, dismiss it, deny it. So I spoke to a group of midwives last night, and one of the midwives raised a concern about her own 2.5-year-old. She had been hospitalized, and she, for about a week and a half, and her baby had to be dramatically and urgently weaned, and her baby didn't recover from it. It was in a great deal of distress. So she started to want to talk to me about it and talk about her baby's pain and her own pain. All the other midwives in the room started saying, "Oh no, it's fine, she'll be fine, she's 2.5, that's every." And I said, "Everybody," I said, "stop it." I said, "This woman is talking about her baby's pain and her pain. Listen to her. Listen to her so she can repair this with her baby. Dismissing her pain and her baby's pain is not going to help her to repair this." So we have a lot of problems. It's not just that no one's listening to this, because, you know, I mean, my book is getting some attention. In America, I was in an important newspaper article in the Wall Street Journal. It's getting a lot of attention, a lot of positive attention from people speaking up saying, "My God, thank you for the courage to speak up about this. This is a critical issue, but also no one values what we do as mothers." But I'm also getting a lot of negative attention from very angry and defensive and guilt-ridden women and men. And so as a therapist, I can tell you that this is what I deal with. Maybe that's why I can write this book, because first, I'm a woman, I'm not a man. So men have tried to write this in their research, and they're called misogynists. Okay, I can't be a misogynist. I'm a woman, and I love women, and I love mothers, and I love babies. And I feel tremendous empathy, so I can't be a misogynist. And in my own way, I'm a feminist, because if feminism means choices, then yeah, right, I made a choice to have children. You don't have to have children. You don't have to have children to have a satisfying, happy life. But if you have children, you have a sacred obligation to give them what they need and care for them. Otherwise, as Penelope Leach said so many years ago, don't have them. Why have them? You don't need to have them to be happy. But if you have them, you have a sacred obligation to care for them, right? Thank you. Thank you all.